Church, this morning we have a special guest today that I am thrilled to be able to introduce to you. Dr. David Reagan from Lamb and Lion Ministries will be our speaker this morning, and he's one of my heroes, one of the men that has been used of God to really challenge people and motivate people to be ready for Jesus' return anytime. And we're grateful too to have Todd Hutchison with us this morning, who is David's muscle. He's his the guy that takes care of him. So we're glad that he's here with us too. And we're glad to have Stoney with us this morning. I got to see Stoney in action at our missions committee meeting on Friday with his baby, Sienna, and he's being a great dad, and so we're thankful that Stoney's going to be introducing and welcoming all of us here this morning. But we want to welcome you that are physically here, but also welcome those who are online. And we believe that God has a purpose and a plan for all of us today, and so we just pray that you will listen for his voice this morning as we come together. So Stoney, come and welcome and pray for us, and then we'll begin the service this morning.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
It's a privilege and an honor to be here in the house of the Lord, to be able to come together and worship our Father together. Before we start service, I just ask that you guys prepare your hearts and please go to prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for waking us up this morning. Thank you for helping all of us make it here safely, Father God. We thank you, Lord, because we do serve a living God, and that you're a God of compassion and love. And we're so grateful, Father, that you have given us a place to just worship you. I pray, Father, that as the word goes on and the service goes on, that our hearts be moved by your Spirit, Father, and that we just be in a place where we're in intimate worship with you. I ask that your hand be over Dr. David, Father God, as he brings your word, Father, and that we can just commune together. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, Cornerstone. We want to welcome you all this morning. Let's stand and let's join our voices and our hearts as we join together in worship.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name. We're calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing.
Show us your power. Show us.
Let's continue in our worship. These are the days of Elijah.
Well, these are the days of Elijah.
That's going to be such an awesome day when we get to see him coming on the clouds. That day when all faith will be vindicated. It's just going to be so awesome. Good morning, everybody. I want to, first of all, welcome you all to today's service. I got a couple of reminders for everybody. First of all, if you're here physically present, I would ask you to please fill out this blue form that is in your bulletin. And if you would please, if you have anything that you want us to pray about, you can put that on the back of the blue form. And we will pray about that Monday morning as a staff. Also, you will find in your bulletin this special envelope. And if you would like to place an offering in this envelope, this specifically goes to feed hungry people both locally and around the world. It's a great ministry. A quick reminder that we do have a deacons meeting today after church. So if you're a deacon, please hang around for a little bit. And we also have a couple of important announcements to keep in mind. First of all, we do have Impact tonight. As of last week, we started a meeting in person again on Sunday evening. So please join us for that. Impact will be at 6 o'clock this evening right here at DCC. And we also got an invitation to be a part of a great service project. There is a ministry that is starting out in South Dallas for women who have been abused to find a place of refuge. And so they need a little bit of help setting up this facility. And so Guy Ringer has invited us to be a part of this. His fund has started it, and so they're looking for about 15 volunteers to help paint and do some construction work on these facilities. And so that's going to be on April 10th. So I would encourage you all to consider joining us in that work. That would be really great if you could help us out. Also, we are starting again with our anchor groups. So some of them are starting later this week. If you were already part of an anchor group, just get in touch with whoever you were with before, and then they'll give you the details. If you are not part of an anchor group already, you can just contact me, and I'll help you get situated with one. But it's exciting stuff that we're finally getting back to meeting in person again, and it's really great. So if you want to be a part of that, please just let me know. This week we are remembering one of our missionaries that we actually, some of us, were able to meet her earlier last week, or some in the missions committee were able to meet her. And this is Megan Lewis, who is working with the Nueva Vida, or the New Life School in Guatemala. And that is our missionary of the week. I'd like to also, well, that is, I think, all the announcements that I needed to give you guys this morning. I just thought there had to be something else, but no, that's it. That's all the announcements. So I just want to ask you all to bow your heads and pray with me this morning. Dear Father, we are so thankful for just how good you've been with us, just how much you've blessed us. We are so grateful that you have considered us your children, that you've given us that privilege, that you sent your Son to die for us so that we may call you Father, so that on that day when he returns with the clouds in power and in glory, that day we will not fear but rejoice, that we will be glad to see his face. And Lord, we praise you this morning, and we want to lift up this service, and our desire is that you will rejoice in hearing the praise that comes from this place and from many places like this around the world. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to lift up so many of our brothers and sisters who are suffering with illness today. We lift up Bob Myers, who continues to have problems with his heart and with his breathing. Lord, we pray for the Creech family as they continue to deal with health problems with young Noah and Mike and Jordan. Lord, I pray that you will keep them healthy, that you will give them strength during this very difficult time of testing. Lord, we pray for the Goodman family. Lord, I pray for Elaine Green and Linda Greenwell, for Sharon Griffin and Arista Lagunes. We thank you for Bob Meskin, that he's back at home. We thank you also for Maddie Jefferson, who had her surgery and is now back at home. And we also thank you for Joe Carroll, who is feeling better today. Lord, I pray for their full recovery and for them to start to feel better. I pray for Ron's sister, sister-in-law Carla. I pray that you'll be with her also as she's finishing up her radiation, and we pray for a full restoration of her. And dear Father, we also lift up our brother, Nathan, and his very busy schedule. We pray that you'll give him stamina and strength, that you'll give him wisdom also, as he carries out the important work that he does. Dear Father, we pray for so many people who have been displaced, so many people who have lost their livelihoods, whose businesses have been shuttered because of this pandemic, all those people who are looking for work, for a way to provide for their families. Father, I pray that you will open up doors for them, that you will provide jobs, that you will open up opportunities, and that they will be able to receive the financial needs, the financial support that they need to support their families and also to share with others. Father, I pray for your guidance as we look for a new place to meet, as we look for a place to use as a base to continue to do the ministry that you've given us to do. Lord, I thank you for the generosity and the faithfulness of all the people that have committed to help raise those funds. And they've been coming in strong. And Father, I pray that you will just guide us, that you will give us the wisdom and show us the place that you would have us meet, that you would have us open up the doors to welcome the people around us to come to know you. Dear Father, I pray for all the missionaries that serve you both here locally and as far away as the opposite side of the globe, for people that are serving you in Japan, in India, in Guatemala, in Mexico, all over the United States, in Europe, for those who are serving you on college campuses where your word is constantly under attack. Lord, I pray that you just give them encouragement, that you will keep them safe as they devote themselves to sharing the gospel and sharing your love with people who have never heard the name of Christ before. Lord, I pray for the servicemen and women who protect us, that you will keep them safe as well, that you will give them encouragement. And Father, I pray for our nation. I pray that you will bring peace, that you will bring understanding, that you will give wisdom to those people who serve in public office, that they will understand your word, that they will know that they serve you as well, Father. Lord, I pray for this church as we move forward, as we take on new challenges, as we try to meet the needs of the people around us, as we try to minister to people who are in financial need, people who are homeless, who are just desperate for the basic necessities of life. We pray that you will open up our eyes and that you will guide us, direct us to those people that we may share your love to them. I pray that you will guide us to those people who are spiritually starving and in distress, that you will lead us to them and that we will be able to share your word with them. And dear Father, I pray that you will be with Dr. Reagan this morning as he shares your word with us, that you will open up our minds, that you will prepare our hearts. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we continue in our worship, I'm going to ask you to stand, and let's give a wave and a greeting to those who are joining us online. If you'll wave to the cameras in the back. Glad you all are joining us online this morning. Blood and righteousness.
Amen. You may be seated. My world was rocked this morning. I got to just tell you, I was minding my own business. I was just having a nice visit with Dr. Reagan before he comes to speak this morning, and then he just dropped a bombshell on me. It just has rocked my world, and I'm still trying to process this whole thing, but he's getting married in June. Now, I don't know who's braver, Dr. Reagan or his wife-to-be, but we're glad. What great news. His wife went to glory just a few months ago in August, and God has orchestrated events to bring about this, and so what great news. I neglected to acknowledge somebody this morning that is very, very important. We're very pleased today to have Kent Greenwell with us. Kent runs the sound over at Valley View Christian Church, and he is our consultant today. This is a remarkable thing as well, because he has come to consult his mother, which is a really good thing. So, Dr. Reagan, come up here. Let me pray for you. And then we're anxious for God to use you today to minister to all of us. Father, I thank you for this man. I pray, Lord, that you will use him powerfully today. I ask, Lord, that you would speak to us what you want to say. And I pray that you will use him to do that. Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your church. And we give this time to you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Okay. There we go. Well, good morning to all of you. I greet you in the name of Jesus, our blessed hope. I want to thank you for the invitation to be back with you. I've been here several times and always been greatly blessed. I want to thank the tech people back there for all of their effort in running this cable so that I can control these PowerPoints from my laptop up here. And I want to thank the worship team for preparing our hearts for the message. You know, when you sing that song, Days of Elijah, it's very dangerous to sing that when you're having a Bible prophecy speaker. That song is not only one of the number one songs of Christianity in the last 20 years, but it's about Bible prophecy from the beginning to the end. And so I could preach all day. I won't, but it was wonderful. In fact, in the year 2000, I was invited to go to England and preach for a month. I started out in London. I went to all of the Channel cities. Then I went to Wales, where I heard the most beautiful singing I've ever heard in my life. Then I went up to Scotland and preached at several churches there, and that was quite an experience. They seemed to know what I was saying, but I never understood one word that they said. I would just shake my head yes and agree to whatever they said. I don't know what I agreed to. And I finally turned to my host, who was from London, and I said, what are these people saying? He said, I have the slightest idea. And we ended up in Northern Ireland in Belfast, and it was just a remarkable trip, but one that was very depressing, because all the churches I went to were dead as a doornail. They were very, very legalistic churches. Every church I went to, they would say, get there an hour beforehand so we can tell you what you can say and what you cannot say. And I would sit down with the leaders of the church, and they say, okay, number one, you must use the official King James Version, not the New King James Version. That's the only version. If you quote anything else, we'll ask you to step down. Number two, you're not to mention Billy Graham. I don't know why they thought I was going to preach on Billy Graham, but they said you can't mention Billy Graham because he's a Catholic compromiser. Number three, you cannot mention the Holy Spirit. If you mention the Holy Spirit, we'll ask you to sit down. It just went on and on and on. And every one of those churches I walked into, every one of them had a big sign that said, no women allowed in this church without a head covering. And I actually asked one of the pastors, I said, what if a woman just wanders in off the street and wants to hear the gospel? He said, she won't hear the gospel here unless she has a head covering. And so I came back very depressed from the whole trip. Here is a nation that once was the center of Christianity, and in the year 2000, only 7% of the people were going to church. Today it's down about 4%. It's just a pagan nation, like our nation is becoming. And so I came back very depressed, and when I got back, there was a big stack of mail on my desk, and right at the top was a brown envelope. I opened it, and there was an album there that somebody had sent me, and it was entitled Revival in Belfast. And I thought, fat chance, and I just threw it aside and forgot about it. But about a month later, I saw it laying there, and I thought, well, I ought to at least listen to it. And I started listening to it, and it was the greatest gospel album I had ever heard in my entire life, featuring the music of Robin Mark, who wrote The Days of Elijah. And I'm a person who loves to worship, and so I decided that I was just going to pay my own way to go to Northern Ireland and meet this man. I took one of my staff members, and the two of us went to Northern Ireland, and they were having a great conference there. In fact, the church only had 300 members. That's a big church in England. And the church was located about three blocks from where the Titanic was built. That was very interesting. And they had rented the largest auditorium in Belfast, an auditorium that seated almost 10,000 people. Madonna, in fact, was there performing at the time. And they refused to rent it to them. They said, what are you going to use with this? And they said, well, we're going to use it to have a worship service. And they said, well, we just don't believe you can pay for this auditorium. And they said, every head of a family in your congregation will have to sign a note that you will guarantee us you're going to pay for what we're going to charge you before you can have this. So every member of the congregation, 300 people, I don't know how many families it was, had to sign that note. And on the night that we had the conference, there were over 8,000 people there. And it was just an incredible experience. I met Robin Mark and found out that God works in strange and mysterious ways. Robin Mark is a businessman, still is to this day. He was a businessman there. He went to his pastor one day and he said, you know, Pastor, I just have these tunes going through my head and these words going through my head, and I want to write music, and I don't know quite how to do it, but I'm going to try. And could I lead in worship? And he said, well, okay, we'll let you lead. And he became their worship leader, and he started writing these incredible songs, and just one after another after another. And he was just a businessman. He still is, but the Lord anointed him to write this beautiful music. So it was a great experience to go there. For those of you who don't know, the ministry I represent is Lamb and Lion Ministries, and the reason we call it that is because God raised it up as a prophetic ministry to teach the fundamentals of Bible prophecy and proclaim the soon coming of Jesus. And those are the two prophetic images that are used by the Old Testament prophets. They talk about the Messiah coming the first time as the suffering lamb, returning as the conquering lion. So that's why we use that. And I mention that because almost every day, in fact, I would say every day at our ministry, we get a text message, an email, or a phone call, a letter saying, I know that somewhere in the Bible it says the lion is going to lie down with the lamb, but I can't find it. So where is it? And we have to tell them it's not there. The Bible never says that the lion is going to lie down with the lamb. It says the wolf will lie down with the lamb and the lion will eat straw with the ox. I even had a woman argue with me about that. She said, well, you're just wrong. It has to be there someplace because every year I get a Christmas card that has a picture of a lion with a lamb. I said, well, maybe you do, but it's not there. I guess it's just more dramatic to show a lion with the lamb than a wolf with a lamb. So that is the nature of our ministry. And I bring you greetings from the staff. And this is one of our theme verses here. When these things, the end time signs, begin to take place, not after, but when they begin, stand up, lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. We have outreach in many ways. One of them is through our television program, Christ in Prophecy. And it's a weekly broadcast, but it's on many, many different days of the week. Every day of the week it's on someplace, because we're 9 different national Christian networks. And we have just had a tremendous response to our message over this television program. We also have an even greater outreach through our website at lamblion.com. No and in the middle, just lamblion.com. And we have a member of our staff, Nathan Jones, who is on that 8 hours a day, answering questions. So it's a very interactive website. And you can go to that website and you can subscribe to our magazine, which comes out every other month, 6 issues a year, 28 pages long, and it's free. We have about 100,000 people subscribing to that magazine now. Most of them get it by email. But if you want a hard copy, there is a charge. Either way, you can sign up at our website for that. And incidentally, we have a table back there of displaying materials, and some of the materials are copies of our Lamplighter magazine. But everything on that table is free. So take whatever you want, as many copies as you want. Everything there is free of charge. You'll find there a 40-page booklet called A Prophetic Manifesto that has to do with the 2 major challenges we face today, and that's the deterioration of society and the growing apostasy in the church. The one on the right, Are You Ready for the Lord's Return, you'll find on that table. That's a shorter one designed for people who think they're Christians but aren't, and for people who are not Christians. It's a witness publication. And then the man who is replacing me in June as the head of this ministry, Colonel Tim Moore, who you had here to speak. Tim has just published a booklet called Looking Forward to the Reign of Jesus Christ. It's about 44 pages long, and you can get that. It's also there. And then the other thing that's free on that table is catalog of our resources. That's the 3 of us there, me on the left, Tim in the middle, and Nathan Jones on the right. And that has all of our resources in it. Now, I always like to begin with a few smiles. And I usually do that with church signs. I have been collecting church signs. The ministry is 41 years old, and I started collecting church signs in 1980. I have over 800 now in 29 different categories, and I never cease to be amazed at what people put on church signs. Or my favorite category is the crazy names of churches. The whole thing began in 1980 when I went on the radio and I started teaching about the signs of the times. And I taught on the signs of the times about 6 months, and at the end of that time, a lady sent me a letter, and she said, "Boy, you really are obsessed with signs." Said, "I've got a picture in this envelope of a sign I just took. Think you would find it humorous." Well, the sign was a picture of a church sign in Canton, Texas, right outside of Canton, and it was the name of the church, Little Hope Baptist Church. And I thought that was very funny. You know, I want to be a member of a Big Hope Church, not a Little Hope Church. And so I got on the radio and I mentioned that, and the next sign I got was one that said Halfway Baptist Church. Well, I don't want to get halfway there. I want to get all the way there. And so people just started sending me signs, and that's how this got started. Well, we've been through a terrible year, what I call the perfect storm. It's just been a horrible year, a year that of the pandemic, 8,000 point drop in the stock market, rioting in the streets, a horrible presidential campaign going on. It's just one thing after another. And I have found in my study of history that whenever great calamities occur, one of the ways that people cope with calamity is with humor. Always humor. And it helps to Franklin Roosevelt during the Great Depression, every press conference he had a joke to tell about the Depression. Even though people were suffering horribly, people liked his jokes because it helped them to suffer, get through the process. The pandemic is nothing to laugh at. People have lost loved ones at it, but people have tried to cope with it with humor, even churches. So, for example, can we uninstall 2020 and install it again? This version has a virus. Jesus cleans the heart, we disinfect the pew. No toilet paper, I guess the roll was called up yonder. I never have been able to figure that out, why there was a run on toilet paper, unless people thought this virus was going to give them diarrhea. I don't know. I don't know what the person. And how about this one? Social distancing does not apply to God. Draw near to Him. And I love this one. due to COVID-19, we are asking rioters to work at home and destroy their own stuff. This next one is my favorite. This too shall pass. Now, it may pass like a kidney stone, but it's going to pass. And it's passing like a kidney stone. And then finally, I just love this one. I want to be like Saul. I want to be on the road to Damascus. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, what I want to talk with you about this morning is the greatest event of the 20th century. The greatest event of the 20th century. Let's pray. Lord, I come to you in the name of Jesus, and I thank you for the way you've already blessed us this morning in worship, in fellowship, and in prayer. And I pray now for you to bless us with your word. Lord, there's not a person here who needs to hear me, but everyone here needs to hear you. So I pray that you will use me as an empty vessel to speak through, and that you will touch hearts for eternity and draw all of us into a deeper relationship with you and motivate us to dig deeper into your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay. The 20th century was full of many momentous events. I think all of you would agree with that. And they were events that I think none of us could have foreseen if we had been alive in 1900. Looking back on that century, what would you identify as the most important event of the 20th century? Well, I was intrigued by that, so one night I got on the internet and I went to Google and I typed in the greatest events of the 20th century, and list after list after list came up. I probably had as many as 50 lists, and I went through them. And as I went through them, I noticed that several of them that had some things in common. Nearly all of them mentioned certain events in the 20th century. And so I compiled some of the most commonly mentioned ones. For example, World Wars I and II, the Lindbergh flight in 1927, the invention of television in 1927, the discovery of the first antibiotic, penicillin, in 1928. Did you know that's why so many people died of the flu during World War I, over 40 million? Because there were no antibiotics. So if you got the flu, you usually developed pneumonia and you died. The first computer in 1936. The very first heart transplant in South Africa in 1967. The first man on the moon, 1969. The invention of the internet, 1969. The first test tube baby, 1978. And the demolition of the Berlin Wall in 1991. As I studied this list, I noticed that many, if not most, of all of the items listed on these lists were dependent upon prior developments that were equally important or even more important. For example, take the Lindbergh flight, dependent upon the invention of airplanes by the Wright brothers in 1903. Or the first man on the moon. Think of all the things that was dependent upon, some of them more important, it seems like. For example, the development of rocket propulsion in 1926, the invention of the computer in 1936, the launching of the first satellite in 1957, and the first man in space in 1961. All of those developments led up to the first man on the moon. The destruction of the Berlin Wall in 1991 was dependent upon a far more important development, and that was the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. And the many marvelous developments in the health sciences since 1900 were dependent upon many discoveries during the 19th century, including the germ theory of disease that was not discovered until the mid-1860s. So, we have many, many great events that are listed. But none of those are the ones that, or is, none of these are the one that is listed as the most important event of the 20th century. Almost unanimously, on all the lists I found, there was one event that they picked as the number one most important event of the 20th century, and that was the dropping of the atomic bomb on Hiroshima in the summer of August of 1945. Well, what an event that was. But that event, like the others, was dependent upon many theories and experiments and tests that preceded it. One that most people are not aware of is the fact that on December the 2nd, 1942, the first self-sustaining, human-made nuclear chain reaction occurred. It occurred underground in the city of Chicago, and if it had gone wrong, it would have blown the city of Chicago off the map. And it almost went wrong. Again, the very first human-made self-sustaining nuclear reaction, December the 2nd, 1942, this is a drawing of it, it occurred under the bleachers at Staff Field, which was the field of the University of Chicago's football stadium. That stadium no longer exists. It was an incredible accomplishment, which was the advent of the nuclear age. The football field, again, is not there today, but if you go there today, what you'll see is this statue, a statue by Henry Moore that marks the spot where the chain reaction took place. That is a mushroom cloud of an atomic explosion. And this past year, I had the opportunity to do something that's been on my bucket list for a long time. I went to South Central New Mexico to visit the Trinity site where the very first atomic bomb was exploded on July 16, 1945. So, we have a long list of momentous developments in the 20th century, but from a biblical viewpoint, none of these constitute the most important event of the 20th century, not a single one of them. All the evaluations I have presented so far have been from a humanistic viewpoint or from a secular viewpoint, but from a spiritual viewpoint, there is an event that took place in the 20th century that is more important than any of these. In fact, I would argue it is more important than all of them put together. And what was that event? It was the reestablishment of the nation of Israel on May the 14th, 1948, because all of end time prophecy focuses upon the Jewish people being back in their land and back in their city in the end times. This was the first indication that we had that we were living in the end of the end times, that we were living on borrowed times, that we're on the threshold of the tribulation. But like many of the great events of the 20th century, which were preceded by events as miraculous or even more important, the same is true of this event. The same is true. There were two miracles that made this possible, and they were miracles even greater than the establishment of Israel. The first was the preservation of the Jewish people. This is a painting of the Jewish people in the 19th century worshiping at the Western Wall in Jerusalem. Just think of it for a moment. God preserved the Jewish people for 2,700 years while they were scattered literally all over this earth. There is no miracle like it. We usually think of the dispersion of the Jewish people occurring in 70 AD when the Romans destroyed the city of Jerusalem, but that is not when it began. The dispersion of the Jewish people began in 722 BC when the Assyrians conquered the northern nation of Israel and scattered those 10 tribes all across Eurasia. So the Jews have been scattered around the world for 2,700 years. No people have ever been scattered who have been able to keep their identity. And yet for 2,700 years, they kept their identity. The second miracle that made possible the reestablishment of the state of Israel was the regathering of the Jewish people in unbelief from the four corners of the earth, which began in the 1890s and continues to this day. And both of these marvelous events, both of them, were clearly prophesied in the Hebrew Scriptures. In fact, precisely prophesied. And so what I'd like to do is to look at those two miracles and begin with the first one, the preservation of the Jewish people. Their preservation, again, has to be one of the greatest miracles of history. It is so remarkable, it is so historically stunning that its uniqueness has been noted and commented on by a great number of secular people. Consider, for example, Arnold Toynbee. Arnold Toynbee was one of the great historians of history. He fully recognized the unusual nature of the Jewish experience. He wrote 10 volumes on this called The Study of History, and in that he developed a concept of the rise and fall of civilizations that applied to 26 civilizations. The only one it did not apply to were the Jewish people, and he recognized that. And so he said of the Jewish people, they are fossils of history, because he said they were the only ones who seemed to be frozen in time, refusing to assimilate into the soup of humanity. Leo Tolstoy also recognized the importance of the preservation of the Jewish people. The great Russian novelist expressed his awe over their preservation in these words. He wrote, "What is the Jew? What kind of unique creature is this, whom all the rulers of all the nations of the world have disgraced and crushed and expelled, persecuted, burned, drowned, and who, despite their anger and fury, continue to live and to flourish. The Jew is the symbol of eternity. To get a feel for how preposterous it is for the survival of the Jewish people throughout history, I want to show you the perspective of a modern-day Jewish man, Rabbi Dov Greenberg. He is the director of Chabad at Stanford University. Chabad is the Jewish Hasidic movement, the ultra-Orthodox movement. When he was asked about the preservation of the Jewish people, here's what he had to say. Imagine that we could travel back in time and say to the great Pharaoh of Moses' time, there's good news and there's bad news. The good news is that one of the nations alive today will survive and change the moral landscape of the world. The bad news is it won't be yours. It will be that group of Hebrew slaves out there building your glorious temples, the children of Israel. Continuing, nothing would sound more outrageous. The Egypt of Pharaoh's time was the greatest empire of the ancient world, brilliant in its arts and sciences, formidable in war. The Israelites were a landless people, powerless slaves. Indeed, already in antiquity, those in power believed that the Israelites were on the verge of extinction. That's how preposterous it is to think about the preservation of the Jewish people. This preservation of the Jewish people throughout 2,700 years of dispersion is mind-boggling. Keep in mind that they were dispersed over 130 nations worldwide, and they were brutally mistreated wherever they went. Will Varner, who is a professor at the Master's College in California, has expressed it this way: no nation in the history of the world has ever been exiled from its land, lost its national existence, lost its language, and then returned as a people to that identical homeland and even revived its ancient tongue. No nation, that is, except one, the nation of Israel. I want to comment for a moment on something he points out there, the loss of their language. When the Jews were dispersed from their land, they stopped speaking Hebrew. The Jews that went to Europe mixed Hebrew with German and came up with a new language called Yiddish. The Jews that went to the Mediterranean basin mixed Hebrew with Spanish and came up with a new language called Ladino. But Hebrew stopped being a spoken language for almost 2,000 years. And yet God raised up a man in the 19th century by the name of Eliezer ben Yehuda. And he was born in one of the Russian provinces. And he was determined he was going to revive the Hebrew language from the dead. He devoted his life to that. He produced a Hebrew dictionary that had over 30 volumes. He tried to find every Hebrew word that had been lost. He tried to manufacture new words. Think of all the words you had to manufacture over 2,000 years. Words for telegram, telegraph, television, all these things. He would not use those words. They had to be pure Hebrew words with pure Hebrew roots. But he did it. And before he died in 1928, the British declared biblical Hebrew to be one of the official languages of Israel. I had a group in Israel one time. We were at the Dead Sea Scrolls Museum, and the centerpiece is the Isaiah scroll, the oldest piece of scripture we have. Complete scroll. I lectured on it. We started to leave, and I heard somebody speaking Hebrew. I turned around, and there was a 12-year-old boy with a pointer, and he was reading that scroll that was written in about, maybe 150 A.D., maybe 200 B.C. He was reading the scroll because the Jews in Israel today speak biblical Hebrew. This has never happened before, that a lost language would be revived from the dead, and yet it was. Well, this raises the question, how did the Jews survive? How in the world did they do this? And there's been many, many different explanations from a humanistic viewpoint that have been given. But there was really only one true answer to that question, and that is they survived supernaturally. Psalm 124 sums it up. Look what it says. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive when their anger was kindled against us. Then the raging waters would have swept over our soul. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us to be torn by their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the trapper. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. This passage expresses an eternal principle concerning God's relationship with the Jewish people. And the author of Psalm 121 sums it up beautifully this way. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. God is the one who has kept Israel alive throughout all these years, and he will continue to do so. The Hebrew prophets were very precise about the fact that God would always preserve the Jewish people. I want you to consider, for example, a symbolic prophecy of Isaiah that was written 2,700 years ago, 700 years before Jesus was born. Here's what he wrote. But Zion, the Jewish people, they say, the Lord has forsaken us. The Lord has forgotten us. But God answers, can a woman forget her nursing child and have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you. And then, in Psalm 121, it's put this way, Isaiah 49, I have engraved you on the palm of my hands. God says, I've engraved you on the palm of my hands. I can never forget you, never, because I just look at my hand and I am reminded of you. Well, that's not the only place where the Bible speaks of God's preservation of the Jewish people. We'll go back to the book of Isaiah in 41. Look what it says in verse 10. Do not fear, I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Behold, all those who are angered at you will be shamed and dishonored. Those who contend with you will be as nothing, and they will perish. Likewise, the prophet Jeremiah, who wrote 75 years after Isaiah, declared that God would preserve the Jewish people. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 11, for I am with you, declares the Lord, to save you, for I will destroy completely all the nations where I have scattered you. Only I will not destroy you completely, but I will chasten you justly and will by no means leave you unpunished. Likewise, the prophet Jeremiah wrote also in chapter 31, thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for the light by day and the fixed order of the moon and the stars for light by night, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. This is what I call the signature of God. You'll find this over and over in the Old Testament scriptures with the prophets. Whenever they get ready to make a major proclamation from God, they will first of all let you know who's speaking. So this is the signature of God. Look at it. Thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for light by day, the fixed order of the moon and the stars for light by night, who stirs up the sea so its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. Okay, we know who's speaking. What do you got to tell us? Here it is. If this fixed order departs before me, declares the Lord, then the offspring of Israel, who also will cease from being a nation forever. Continues, thus says the Lord, if the heavens above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out below, then I will also cast off the offspring of Israel for all that they have done, declares the Lord. When is the Lord going to cast off Israel? He's going to cast off Israel when the fixed order of the universe ceases. When the sun stops coming up, the sun stops going down, when the seasons stop coming, that is when he will cast off Israel. When will he cast off Israel? When we have explored all the heavens above and all the depths of the ocean beneath. When is God going to cast off Israel? Never. Never. He will preserve them, and he did so. Over and over we have this promise. So, this is the situation. The Jewish people continue to exist today. They continue to come back to Israel from the 130 nations around the world. And these prophecies are being fulfilled before our very eyes. Okay, let's take a look now at the second miracle. And that is that enabled the reestablishment of Israel. And that miracle is namely the promise that God will one day regather the Jewish people in unbelief. Now, there's two kinds of prophecies in the Old Testament about regathering. There are many, many, in fact, the most prolific prophecy in the Old Testament over and over and over like a broken record is that in end times God will regather the Jewish people in unbelief. And then there are also prophecies that the time will come when God will regather the Jewish people in belief. He's regathering them in unbelief now. At the end of the tribulation, they will be brought to the end of themselves. And when they're brought to the end of themselves, they will look upon him whom they pierced, they will weep and wail and mourn, they will receive Yeshua as their Messiah, and God will regather all believing Jews back to Israel at the end of the tribulation. So let's take a look now at this second miracle, and the promise that God's going to regather them in unbelief, which is continuing to this day. This is a photo taken in 2015 of Jews coming back home to Israel. And let's take a look at just three, of the most important of these prophecies. The first is found in Jeremiah chapter 16. Now, this is an incredible prophecy. And you have to know something about Jewish history and Jewish beliefs to understand how important it is. So let's read it very carefully. Therefore, behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when it will no longer be said, as the Lord lives who brought up the sons of Israel out of the land of Egypt. But as the Lord lives who brought up the sons of Israel from the land of the north and from all the countries where he had banished them, for I will restore them to their own land, which I gave to their fathers. Folks, this is an incredible statement. Every Jew, whether religious or not, knows that the most important event in the history of the Jewish people is their deliverance from Egyptian captivity. Every Jew is taught that. And what this scripture is saying is that when history is over and done and the Jews look back at their history, they will no longer swear by the God who delivered them from Egyptian captivity, but they will swear instead by the God who delivered them from the four corners of the earth and brought them back to Israel. In other words, when history is over and done and the Jewish people look back on their history, they're going to consider the regathering that is going on right now to be a greater miracle than their deliverance from Egyptian captivity. That's a mouthful. It's the same God. The same God delivered them from Egyptian captivity that's bringing them back today. But the one that they're going to be most enthralled with is the one who brought them back from the four corners of the earth. So that is the age in which we're living, and the average Christian has no idea of how important that age is right now. What we are witnessing as we look at the Jewish people coming back from all over the world, what a deal it is. Well, here's the second prophecy, Isaiah chapter 11. Isaiah 11, beginning with verse 10. Then in that day, the nations will resort to the root of Jesse, that's David, who will stand as a signal for the peoples. That word signal there is the same word as used for banner, flag, signal, whatever. There are many different translations of it. But what that is saying is in end times, there's going to be a banner raised, a flag raised, a signal raised that will have the root of Jesse on it. Do you know what the Israeli flag looks like? What does it have on it? The Star of David. Who is the root of Jesse? David. So this is saying what the flag of Israel is going to look like in the end times. It's going to have the root of Jesse on it. It's going to be like a magnet to draw the Jewish people from the four corners of the earth. Then it will happen on that day that the Lord will again recover the second time with his hand the remnant of his people who will remain from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, Elam, Shinar, Hamath, and from the islands of the sea. And he will lift up a standard, there's the word again, for the nations and assemble the banished ones of Israel and will gather the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. I grew up in an amillennial church, a church that said Jesus would never put his foot on this earth again, did not believe in a millennial reign of Jesus. And they always argued that this particular passage was fulfilled when the Jews came back from Babylon. Folks, this was not fulfilled when the Jews came back from Babylon. Look, first of all, he says, then in that day, I don't know how familiar you are with Isaiah, but every time without exception that Isaiah mentions in that day, he is talking about the end times. Just go through and check it. Every time he is referring to the end times, not to something that happened thousands of years ago. Or consider this, it's going to be a second regathering. The first regathering was the regathering of the Jews from Babylon. This is going to be a second regathering. And look where they're going to come from, the islands of the sea. That is a Jewish colloquium for the whole world. And it's proved in the next verse, from the four corners of the earth is where they're going to come from. And who's going to come? The Babylonian regathering was the people of Judah. But look what's going to happen with this regathering. It's going to be the banished ones of Israel, that's the northern kingdom, and the southern kingdom, Judah. It's going to be all the Jews from all the tribes who are going to come back home in the end times. And that is exactly what we are witnessing today. The third prophecy I want to share with you is taken from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36. The prophet was placed in a valley of dry bones. I always get amused at that. He was preaching to dry bones. And I want to tell you, I have been at churches where I felt like I was preaching to the dry bones, to the chosen frozen, I call them. But here he was preaching to these dry, dead bones. And suddenly this poor man, as he's preaching, these bones start rattling. They start moving around. They start coming back alive. And he was just mystified by what this was all about. So here's what it says about it. Ezekiel 37, beginning with verse 11. Then he, the Lord, said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, who say? The Jewish people say, our bones are dried up and our hope has perished. We are completely cut off. But prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves, my people, and I will bring you back into the land of Israel. Now, folks, this is what I call a symbolic prophecy. Symbolic prophecy. The dry bones here represent the Jewish people in their end time dispersion with no hope of ever existing again as a nation. The resurrection from their graves represents their regathering from the nations of the world. And we don't have to guess at this because the Lord makes this very explicit. Look what he says in verse 21. Say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will take the sons of Israel from among the nations where they have gone, and I will gather them from every side and bring them back into their own land. Another firm promise of God that he's going to regather the Jewish people in the end times. Folks, I was talking to a friend recently, an older man that asked me to go to lunch with him, and I was sitting there talking with him, and suddenly he looked at me and he said, David, wouldn't it have been exciting to live in Bible times? And I said, sir, you are living in Bible times. We are living in Bible times today where we are seeing prophecies fulfilled that were made over 2,500 years ago. And we're seeing one after another fulfilled before our very eyes. We are living in Bible times. We're living in a time when God is doing one of the greatest miracles of history. In 1900, there were 40,000 Jews in all of Israel. At the end of World War II, there were 600,000. Today, there are 6.8 million, more than were killed in the Holocaust. Very soon, there'll be 7 million. And when it hits 7 million, that'll be half of all the Jews in the world will be in the land of Israel. And we know from what the Bible says that there's going to be intense persecution, increasing persecution of the Jews in the end time, which is going on in Europe right now. Jews are fleeing France as fast as they can get out. And so we know that by the time the Lord is here, most of the Jews in the world, not all, but most, will be back in the land of Israel. Let's pause for a summary. I have pointed out that God performed two great miracles among the Jewish people that made possible the greatest event of the 20th century. One was their preservation during 2,700 years of dispersion. The second was their regathering, which is going on from the four corners of the earth even to this day. Every day in Israel, a plane arrives with refugees coming from some part of the world. These two miracles made possible the greatest event of the 20th century, which was the reestablishment of the State of Israel, which took place in this building in Tel Aviv on May the 14th, 1948, when David Ben-Gurion read the Declaration of Independence in this small room that will seat at most only 150 people. And 11 minutes later, President Harry Truman recognized the State of Israel in this short recognition that he wrote. What a day that was. The first nation in the world to recognize Israel was ours. So, what is the significance of all this to you and me, to the church of the 21st century? Why in the world should we be even concerned about what God is doing among the Jewish people? Well, let me give you some reasons. First, it is evidence of God's sovereignty. We have to understand God is sovereign. It's proof that God is on his throne, that God is in control, that God still hears prayers, that God still answers prayers, and that God still performs miracles. In Psalm 2, which was written by David 1,000 years before Jesus, the psalmist declared that while the political leaders of the world are making fun of God, shaking their fists at God, saying, who are you, tell me what to do, that God sits on the throne and laughs. Every time I get down from watching the news and think, you know, the whole world is just going to hell in a handbasket and our nation is just falling apart at the seams, I think of Psalm 2. God is in control. God is on the throne. God has the wisdom, he has the power, and he has the knowledge to take all of the evil of mankind and the evil of Satan and turn it into the triumph of Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter what Satan throws at him. God can turn it around to the triumph of Jesus Christ. He already proved that conclusively with the cross. Satan thought he had his greatest victory at the cross. And yet through the power of the resurrection, God turned the cross from the most dastardly event in history to one of the most glorious events in all of history. So God is sovereign and is proof positive when we look at what God is doing among the Jewish people. Second, it is a testimony of God's faithfulness. God has made promise after promise to the Jewish people, promises made 2,500 years ago, which he is now fulfilling before our very eyes. God never makes a promise that he does not fulfill. And just because he is doing this, we can be absolutely certain that as he is fulfilling every promise he's made the Jewish people, he's going to fulfill every promise that he's made to the church. That one day very soon, almost any moment now, Jesus will appear in the heavens. There'll be the shout of an archangel, the blowing of a trumpet, and the rapture of the church will occur. We'll be taken out of this world. We know that following that, the great tribulation is going to occur. We know at the end of the tribulation, the second coming is going to occur, and Jesus is going to return, and he's going to reign in glory and majesty over all this earth. He will reign. What a day that will be when he is reigning and the earth is flooded with peace, righteousness, and justice as the waters cover the sea. And we know that at the end of that millennial reign, he's going to take us off this earth and we're going to be put in that new Jerusalem that he is preparing right now. And in new bodies, glorified, immortal bodies inside the new Jerusalem, he's going to lower us down to the new earth. And we're going to live in his presence forever and ever and ever. And we can be absolutely certain he's going to keep every one of those promises because he's keeping every promise he made to the Jewish people. What's the significance to us? It's a demonstration of God's grace, his amazing grace. He's bringing the Jewish people back to their land in unbelief. They have not repented. He's bringing them back in unbelief. I've had people tell me this can't be a work of God. It can't be because they haven't repented. Let me tell you, the grace of God is unbelievable. Yes, the Jewish people are stubborn. Yes, they're rebellion. Yes, they're stiff-necked. That's what their own prophets say about them. But so are we. We Gentiles are not any better. And yet God never gave up on us, just as he's never given up on the Jewish people. He has pursued us and pursued us, you and every one of you here. He pursued you and pursued you until you finally bent your knee and accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. He is demonstrating his grace through what he's doing with the Jewish people. It's a marvelous demonstration of grace. My wife one time told me, she said, "Honey, when you preach about the Jewish people and how God is so patient with them and has been so tolerant with them and put up with them over the years and all their nonsense that they've done and the idolatry and everything else, and yet he continues to love them," said, "you make me want to be a Jew." And I said, "No, you would never want to be a Jew." But Jewish people a long time ago said, "I'm just fed up with you. I'm tired of you. You're out of here." And in fact, did you know that the vast majority of all churches on planet Earth today teach that? They teach that because the Jewish people refused to accept Jesus as their Messiah, God washed his hands of them, has no purpose left, and all of the blessings that he gave to Israel are now given to the church. None of the curses, just the blessings. It's called replacement theology. It's a horrible theology. It's a theology that has resulted in rampant anti-Semitism. But it's not true. It's just not true. God has not washed his hands of the Jewish people. Did you know that the three most hated chapters in the Bible by the church for 2,000 years have been Romans 9 through 11? You know why? Because Romans 9 through 11 says God still loves the Jewish people. God still has a purpose for the Jewish people. God is going to bring a great remnant of the Jewish people to salvation. And the church doesn't like that. And the church does not preach those three chapters. So, God, unfathomable love. We just cannot even begin to recognize it. And then the fifth reason it's significant to us is because it's proof positive that we are living in the season of the Lord's return. Again, all of end-time Bible prophecy focuses upon Israel. And the fact that Israel has been reestablished, the fact that Israel is going strong today, the fact that they're still coming from all over the world indicates that we are living on borrowed time. Some of you may have a copy of the Scofield Study Bible. Scofield, that's the most popular study Bible that's ever been produced. It's still the bestseller. It was produced in 1909 when Scofield was a pastor right here in Dallas, Texas. And the amazing thing is it was published by the most prestigious publisher in the world, the Oxford University Press, because he happened to know somebody there in England. And do you know what happened when he got to Ezekiel 36 and 37, where it talks about a Russian invasion of Israel in the end times with all these what are today Muslim allies? He said this. He said, "I don't understand this, and I can't explain it, but the Bible says it, and therefore I believe it. In the end times, Russia, with all these allies, will invade Israel." Now think about that. That's 1909. Israel did not exist. There was no possibility Israel would ever exist, and Russia was a Christian Orthodox nation. It took a lot of belief, but he said, "I believe the Word of God. I believe it for what it says." He often said, "If the plain sense makes sense, don't look for any other sense or you'll end up with nonsense. Just take it for its plain sense meaning." And he said, "That's the plain sense meaning. Russia's going to invade Israel in the end time." We don't even stop and think about that today. Israel exists now. We know that Russia is an enemy of Israel. We know that Russia's going to invade Israel sooner or later. But that is the reason I say over and over, we are living in Bible times, and we should praise God for the fact that we are a generation that is being given the privilege of seeing God work in history like he's never worked before, and except for the first coming of Jesus. What a day this is that we could be very well the terminal generation. There is not one prophecy, not one that has to be fulfilled for Jesus to simply appear in the heavens for his church in the rapture. That can happen any moment. There's not a prophecy that has to be fulfilled. There's a lot of prophecies that have to be fulfilled before the second coming, but not for the rapture of the church. And so the message this morning is prepare yourself for the Lord's soon return, for his appearance in the rapture, because it's going to happen any moment. You know what is the most important sign of the times? More important than any other sign? It's not really Israel. Israel is the most important signs, but there's a sign that overreaches them. The most important sign of the times is convergence. For the first time in all of history, all the signs have converged. There's not a single one that is missing. All of them. And so we know we are living on borrowed time. The message for unbelievers is a call to repentance. What the Holy Spirit is saying to unbelievers today is rush into the arms of the Lord Jesus Christ right now before it's too late. Because when Jesus returns, he's coming in wrath to pour out the wrath of God upon those who have rejected the grace, mercy, and love of God. And what is the message for believers? It is a call to holiness and a call to evangelism. I often have pastors tell me, I never preach Bible prophecy, David, because it's all pie in the sky. I have to deal with problems that people have right here and now. I've got every problem known to man in my church, and I got to preach about those problems. And I said, well, the problem is you don't understand the impact of Bible prophecy. If you can ever convince a congregation of two things, you will transform that congregation. Number one, Jesus really is returning. The average Christian believes it here, but they don't believe it there. And it doesn't become a real belief that has any impact upon your life until it moves to your heart. We believe it in our mind, but we don't believe it in our heart because we don't live like Jesus might come any moment. But if you can convince them, number one, Jesus is really coming back. And number two, it is an event that can occur any moment. You know what will happen? They'll be motivated to holiness, and they'll be motivated to evangelism, and I don't know what more you could expect. The very first gospel sermon that was ever preached on the day of Pentecost, from beginning to end, was a sermon about Bible prophecy. All Peter did was stand up and say, the prophet said this, Jesus fulfilled it. The prophet said this, Jesus fulfilled it. The prophet said this, Jesus fulfilled it. And they interrupted the sermon and said, what must we do to be saved? Don't tell me that Bible prophecy has no significance. So the question for you, the question for me, the question for every person watching is, are you ready? If the Lord appears today for his church, are you ready? Will you go forth like a calf released from a stall, rejoicing? Or will you crawl into a hole in the ground and cry out for the rocks and the mountains to fall upon you? Well, 71 years ago, in 1950, when I was 11 years old, I received Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and he's kept me to this day. And because of that, every morning when I get up, I look at the sky and I cry out in my heart, Maranatha, 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 come quickly, Lord Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the signs of the times that point to this being the day of your son's return. May we live like we really believe it. May we commit our lives to holiness. May we commit our lives to sharing the gospel with as many people as we can, as quickly as we can. I thank you for this church's heart for missions, how they're reaching out all over the world to tell people about Jesus. And I pray you'll continue to bless that outreach. And if there's any person here this morning who has never received Jesus as Lord and Savior, or any person watching over the internet, I pray this will be the day of their salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus tells us in John chapter 10 that his sheep hear his voice. And I hope and pray that we have heard the voice of Jesus this morning to get ready. So if you're here this morning, we're going to share a time of communion together. And Paul says when we come together to share the Lord's Supper, we should examine ourselves and listen for his voice. And then we're going to have a time of invitation after we share communion together. So let's all stand together as we prepare for our time of communion.
Oh Lord, my God, When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I God his son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul,
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep, I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. He's speaking to Jewish people here, but he's telling the Jewish people, I have other sheep that are not of this fold, and I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. One of the joys of communion is Jesus and Paul say that in Christ there is neither Jew or Greek, bond or free, but we're all one in Jesus because he died for us all. And so Jesus said, this is my body broken for you. Take and eat it. Let's eat together. And Jesus said, and this is the blood of the new covenant for Jew and Greek. Drink all of it. Let's drink together. Father, we thank you that you bring us all together in Jesus. We're thankful, Lord, for the joy of being grafted in to the vine of the Jewish nation. We're thankful, Lord, that we're all recipients of your grace and your mercy and your love. And Father, we just ask and pray that you would help us to hear your voice, because you've told us that your sheep hear your voice. Help us, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, there's a verse of scripture after the resurrection that I just really love. Mary and the women came to the tomb, and it says, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stopped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet, and they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? And she said to them, "They've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she heard his voice. I don't know where you are this morning after hearing God speak to all of us, but the most important thing is you need to hear him call your name. He's calling you to himself. If you would like to receive Jesus as your Savior, if you would like to become a part of the Cornerstone family, if you just want us to pray for you this morning, that's what we want to do as we share and sing together. Please join us.
When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart, then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
Dr. Reagan, thank you so much. Thank you for coming. And we hope and pray that all of us have heard God's voice this morning and that we will leave as his ambassadors. Let's pray together and then we'll be dismissed. Our Father in heaven, we just desperately need, Lord, to hear you speak to us. And we're grateful, Lord, that you do. We're thankful that you take us into your confidence, that you speak to our hearts, that you speak to our minds. And Lord, we pray that as we're fueled by the security that comes by knowing that you are involve us in your plans, that you share with us the deepest longings of your heart, that Lord, you will help us to operate in life as your children, as people redeemed by the blood of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for these moments and pray your blessings on us now as we leave. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.